Well, Pastor Steve is going to be doing the welcome here in a moment, but I'm going to jump up here and say hello first because I want to take care of a little bit of church business, if you don't mind. And you have received already our nominating committee report. We passed this out, made this available last week. It has been available on the website. And I know that we've got some deacons who have some copies right now, so I'm looking back there for Danny. Not for Danny, excuse me, for Richie. And here he comes right now. So we don't have a lot of these printed out. It is available on the website, but maybe one per family. We should be fine with that. And, of course, only for members. If you're a visitor, you don't care about these things. I don't blame you. But I do want to make you aware of a few changes that have taken place. Now, first of all, the whole point of having this presented to you twice is so that we can find any errors in the report, make any corrections, and certainly if there's any major concerns that you might have with one of our leaders, that you need to have an opportunity to bring that to us. Fortunately, the only things that were brought to our attention is some pretty minor things and one major thing. I say major. The most important thing that got left off last week's report, for some reason, we failed to put the health committee on this report. We call it the fitness ministries. And so that has now been included. You'll see all the changes as you see this. They're going to be highlighted in yellow. Okay? So if you see something highlighted, that means it's been added since our last report. And if you see it highlighted with a little line crossed through it, that means they've been taken off of that section. So there were some people who were included where they shouldn't have been, and some people who should have been included who weren't. But here's the thing to look for on these reports. On the front cover, you'll see highlighted nominated committee final report. Make sure that's the one you're looking at. If it doesn't say final report, throw it in the trash because it's not correct. Okay? So notice that addition of the fitness ministries, that is the health committee. We've also removed Rachel Davis from the elementary school board. Her term is up. She should have been, she should not have been included on that list. So we thank her for her service, but she's now done with that. We also added Clara Redding to our junior deaconesses. That should have been included. And we apologize for that, but she's now there. Same thing on the technicians video technicians. We should have included Mercedes Love as part of the video team. So her name has been included. And there was one more. Latanya Schmidt will no longer be a part of the decorating committee. With our change in our personal life, that makes some sense. That's it. Those are the only changes that we have to make you aware of. So here's the way this is going to work. After you get a second to look at it, hopefully you've already had time to look at this online and give it consideration. The way nominating committee reports work, you either vote the whole thing in or you vote the whole thing out and send it back to the nominating committee to rework. However, if you vote to not accept it and send it back, we will ask you to come and share with the nominating committee your reasons. We don't want to go into that in a public format like this. So just bear that in mind. If you see an issue that needs to be addressed before we make this final, that's absolutely your right. You can vote no, but just know that we will assemble the nominating committee and we'll meet with you and discuss the reasons, whatever your concerns may be. Okay? If we vote it up, we're voting it all up. There's no line item vetoes is the point. Does everybody understand? We're all good. Okay. So you've had a chance to look at this all week long. I've made you aware of some of the minor changes. Oh, there was also some changes in spelling. We did some of those things, as you would expect. Hopefully we got those all correct. But I'm looking now for a motion to accept this report. We have a motion to accept. We have a second to accept. So we're voting the report all in or all out. So let's take a vote. Let's just do it by raised hands. All in favor of accepting the nominating committee report for 2022 and 23, please raise your hand up nice and high. Thank you. Anybody opposed to this and needs to meet with the nominating committee? Well, you just made my morning. That just makes my life a whole lot easier. But praise God for the fact that we've got so many men and women and kids who are wanting to serve in their local church. Let me tell you something. It is a blessing. Let me make one more appeal. We're still looking to fill up our delegates for the conference constituency meeting, and I want to say again, if you've never been to one, you should go if you can make it. It would be a great thing to see, especially if you're a young member or a new member, just to see the larger mechanism at work. It's inspiring, and it's good to see that picture of the church that we don't see from week to week. So you can just go to the website there, the same way we've been looking at this, that link is available, and you can volunteer to do that. And we'll be taking care of that now in the coming weeks. Don had a question. September the 25th, I believe that's correct. September the 25th, thank you for the thumbs up back there, Elder Hewitt. September the 25th, it'll be at Madison Campus Church. It's a large enough facility. It's going to be inspirational. There'll be a sermon, there'll be singing, there'll be reports from the conference. It's one of my favorite things to do. It only happens once every 5 years, but if you get an opportunity to go and represent the Highland Church, take it. It's a good opportunity. So let us know if you want to be involved in that, and we'll help you with that. Pastor Steve, that's all I have. I'm going to go get ready for baptism. What do you say?
Sounds like a good thing to do. All right. So I give you an official welcome, even though you've already been welcomed. And if you are visiting us today, we would love to know that you are here. We have this blue card that's in the pew in front of you. And you can fill that out or whatever portion of it you like and just put it in the offering box, which is straight through those double doors right in the foyer, or give it to a deacon or an elder. Anyone who's got one of these little badges on it can take care of it, get it where it needs to go. We also have a digital way of doing this. You can get out your phone and send a text message, and you send, the number you will text is 84576. And the message you'll put in there is HSDA, for Highland Seventh-day Adventist. And then you text that, and it will text you back and ask you a few questions. You won't go on a mailing list. It'll keep you on there forever and send you spam. It's just a way for us to know that you're here. So I want to cover just a few announcements that I've been asked to highlight. If you look in your bulletin, you'll know it is packed. In fact, we had to do some tricks just to get it all in there. So go ahead and take a close note of all that is in this, all the things that are coming up. I was asked to remind you about the Empowered Preaching Seminar. Dr. Ruckel has been very much enjoying that, and he tells me you don't even have to be a professional preacher to benefit from what's being shared. So there's the information about that is in your bulletin. Also, now that the weather is getting nice, there is a group that is informally getting together on most Sabbaths and picnicking out at the pavilion up the hill. We started doing that when everybody was isolated for COVID, and it was a way we could get together and still be outdoors. And it was a great thing we did, and we enjoyed it, and we just have continued doing it. Now, because it's not a formal church potluck, it's not organized by the deaconesses or anything like that, it's a little bit hit and miss. So if you're expecting to come and there be a picnic, there might not be this week. So we have a way to deal with that. If you're on Facebook, search for Highland Picnic Association, or HPA, Highland Picnic Association. Ask to join that group, and that's where we share and say, hey, anybody going to picnic this time or that time? It's church members. It's not excluded to church members, but it tends to be church members. It's an unofficial gathering, but y'all are welcome to just check that out. Now, if you're not on Facebook, congratulations, your life is much better. But you can, and if you want a picnic, just ask me or ask Kathy Ross or Rhonda whether there's going to be a picnic this particular week if you're not already on Facebook. So Highland Picnic Association, and you can, what we tend to do is it's very relaxed, and you spend a little bit of time, we eat together, and then some people leave right away. Some people might stay and chat all day, and the kids play out in the field and stuff, so it's a good time to be had. This Thursday is graduation. Am I right on that? Or is it next Thursday? Yeah, it is this Thursday. This Thursday is graduation for our eighth grade. And come on out, support the eighth graders from Highland Elementary School. They would love to have you come and say, good job, and we'll see you next year at Highland Academy, right? And then next weekend, starting Friday, And then events on Sabbath, and then culminating on Sunday is our Highland Academy graduation. And I noticed that the graduation for the year 2022 starts on the 20th and goes to the 22nd. Pretty cool, huh? Now you won't forget that. All right. I think those are the major announcements I have. We have some membership transfers to deal with. If I can get the Johnsons to come on up. And while they're coming up, we have a first reading for Betty Martinez. She is transferring to the Portland SDA Church. And so that'll be a first reading. We'll vote on that one. Maybe not next week because of all the graduations, but when we can. And we have the opportunity to welcome in a new family. Now, we dealt with the first reading for Eric a while back, but he wanted to wait until his wife could be here. They're in this transition mode. How many of you have done this where, like, you get a job, but you've got to move, and your family can't quite move at the same time because Logan is a counselor in Chattanooga, someplace in the Chattanooga area. And so she's a school counselor there, and so she had to finish out her school year. Well, we needed him to start right away. Eric, by the way, is our advancement director, vice president for advancement is your official title, right?
Principal.
Vice principal for advancement. Sorry, I think I made that mistake one other time. Vice principal for advancement. And so he's been a blessing on our campus already. And so this will be our second reading, voting Eric in from Upper Columbia Academy Adventist Church. And Logan is joining us this week by profession of faith. Her membership is a little bit different, how that all worked out. And so it just works out that way. I've had a great conversation with her, and she is on fire for the Lord. And she will also, next year, be the one that's directing our new student counseling center, which you have called Center for Student Success. That's a pretty fancy name, Center for Student Success. And so it's a blessing to be able to have her in our community as well, to be able to provide that emotional and clinical help to help our kids to operate at their very best. This will be for both the academy and the elementary school. So that's a blessing. So because we're doing it slightly differently, we're going to vote on them separately. So all in favor of welcoming Eric in, say aye. All right. And I should say welcome. That's how I normally say welcome. All right. And for Logan, for welcoming her in by profession of faith, who would like to vote welcome for her as well? Welcome. All right. Let's give them a hand in as we welcome them in. So we're glad to have you part of the family. All right. It's neat to have a school that is growing and expanding and offering new opportunities, and the Lord is blessing at Highland Academy and Highland Elementary School, and we're so thrilled. I don't know if you saw recently on Highland Elementary put out an advertisement saying we still have openings in these certain grades. The reason is because some of our classrooms are full. Praise the Lord for that. Yes, so I believe that people are starting to sense a need in this world for a Christian worldview, and I totally concur with that. I'd like to invite Dr. Littell to come up and talk to us about our offering and all that.
Good morning, everyone. Galatians 6:2, carry each other's burdens, and this way you fulfill the law of Christ. Your Adventist Community Services works with the local conferences and disaster response agencies to equip volunteers to serve and assist the community during disasters with assessments, shelters, home reconstruction, emotional and spiritual care. When you give to Adventist Community Services and ADRA, you make it possible for the Adventist Church to respond immediately, both nationally and locally, to help survivors of floods, earthquakes, and fires. This last year, our community services was able to help in the tornado in Kentucky, the flood that was in Waverly, we assisted down there, and in St. Vincent's in the Caribbean where the volcano erupted. We were able to give money for each of these locations to assist there. We want to thank everyone for your dedicated ongoing support of Adventist Community Services, whether it's through giving, volunteering, or even your prayers make a difference. We are currently closed for camp meeting, but we'll be reopening again the middle of June in our thrift store. For your offering, you can give in the foyer, online, or in the office. Please mark, if you want to give specifically to this, for Adventist Community Services locally or through the North American Division where you wish your funds to go. Please also remember our local budget. We had a finance committee this week and we are doing very well with our finances. Only one little negative is that we had a heater that broke right before the evangelistic series in February, which cost $9,000 to fix. So we're just about $3,000 short on our budget for the year, which that is still fantastic for all we've spent on evangelism and things going on this year. If you could stand for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to give you our offering this morning, thinking of those less fortunate that are going through crisis in their lives. We pray that this offering will lift the burdens of people going through struggles. We pray that our local church will be a center of influence in our community. Please send the Holy Spirit to reveal more of your great, marvelous, everlasting love to us. Open heaven to bless our church that we may reveal our love for you to our community. In Jesus' name, amen. Please remain standing for our opening song, which is hymn number 10, Come Christians Join to Sing.
You may be seated.
Watch your step. Well, we were at our church board meeting this past Tuesday night. And we noticed that there was a spike in our water bill. Do you know why? Praise the Lord. We have been filling up this baptistry quite a bit, and that is money well spent, if you ask me. It's just evidence that the Lord is at work in the Highland community. And it just goes to show you when we, you know, when we're faithful, when we present God's word and we share with our community the good news of Jesus' soon return, and we take seriously our ministry to our children, the Holy Spirit gets involved and he blesses. And we've really seen that take place over the last, well, several months. But certainly as we wind up our ministry at both the elementary school and the academy, we're seeing young people come forward, motivated by the Holy Spirit, to give their life to Jesus. And I want to present to you one fine young man. This is Daniel Bagshaw, otherwise known as CB, right? So this is CB, Daniel. We're going to use his given name today as he gives his life to the Lord. Daniel's 10 years old. He is a fifth grader, just finishing his fifth grade year. And he's been through our baptismal class at the school. He's been through our Sabbath school classes. Most importantly, he sees the witness of his family and his friends and his teachers. And he has made a decision to publicly commit his life to the Lord Jesus and to follow him with the rest of his days. And I know that there are many people. I asked him, who's here to support you today? And he says, oh boy, there's a lot. So if you are, surely mom and dad, stand up. Brothers, sisters, family members, we're asking you to stand wherever you are. Very good, very good. And, oh, they look happy. Don't they look happy? They do look happy. If you are or have been one of CB's teachers, please stand up where you are, too. Whether it be at the elementary school or whether it be in one of our Sabbath school divisions, please stand up. Pathfinder director or adventurer director. Anybody who's had any kind of influence in that capacity. You're a part of this, right? We know that the Lord calls together communities because, you know, he witnesses through all of us in various ways. And you've played a part in this decision. And I know that there's others here, friends, dear friends, who want to stand in support of Daniel. And I would ask you to stand as well. And I suspected this to be a large group. So we thank you for your support. And I see future teachers standing. That's a good sign. All right. Daniel, do you believe that Jesus offers forgiveness for sins? And do you accept his forgiveness and his invitation to follow him the rest of your life? And is it your desire to join his remnant church in these last days of earth's history? Amen. Well, Daniel, because of your commitment to Jesus made publicly here and shown in your life, we baptize you in the name of the Father, his Son Jesus, in the Holy Spirit. You know, we have two others waiting to be baptized. You're going to hear lots of praying, but I think it's appropriate. Let's bow our heads and ask the Lord to bless Daniel. Lord, thank you. Thank you for your goodness and mercy. Thank you that you have been a part of Daniel's life since before he can even remember. He's your son. And today he has made it public that he desires to follow Jesus for the rest of his life. Lord, we pray that you fill him with your Holy Spirit. Help him not only to be saved when you come, but to be a powerful witness for Jesus throughout his life so that others too can experience the wonderful saving grace of Jesus. Thank you for being a part of his life. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Looking back of how Christ came into my family, it was through my are standing up, they're part of this church community, my friend. What that means is that they have permission from myself and your parents to encourage you. Okay? Sometimes you're going to get discouraged, my friend, but they're going to be here to encourage you. They're going to be here to continue to tell you, hey, man, you got to go to church, man. You come back from college, man, they're going to ask you, hey, man, you been involved in church? And I know you're going to say yes. Yes. So, Misael, because you love Jesus, and because you have accepted the sacrifice of his death and his resurrection in your life, and because you want to be part of this remnant of church, which is the Seventh-day Adventist Church, it's an honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Kind of a surprise, at least for this Sabbath. Praise the Lord, this is my second Sabbath in a row in this baptistry. Let's keep that water bill up. Amen. God is good. God has been working on the campus of Highland Academy. I appreciate y'all's prayers. I know many of you prayed for the Holy Spirit to be moving at our academy, and those prayers are being answered. So I'm excited to be here with, I call her Mia because that's how I was introduced to her. And Mia and I have known each other for a while. When I moved to the campus of Mount Pisgah Academy, I met Mia, who had just finished the fourth grade. So then I was blessed to come here and have her in my freshman Bible class, sophomore Bible class, and of course she is a senior now in senior Bible class. And during the recent week of prayer a few months ago, she took a stand. Well, she didn't actually take a stand, but she gave me a look that said, I'm too shy to stand, but I want to be baptized. And man, we have had so many studies at our house most Sabbath afternoons since February. Mia and Callion and Judy and Adrian have been meeting at our house. We have lunch together. We study the Bible all afternoon into the evening. And sometimes we just have a good old time and play games into the wee hours of the night. So we've enjoyed those times together, enjoyed those Bible studies, and it really is a blessed privilege to be baptizing serves you and your church, Lord God. Put a hedge of protection around her, Lord God, to save her from trying to mess with her, Lord. We rebuke him in the name of Jesus. Just bless her as she goes on and graduates soon, Lord. Just may she live a life of service as she's dedicated her life to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, as I've stated before, if the Holy Spirit's been working on your heart, let's make it 3 weeks in a row with another baptism. Amen.
Amen.
Timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day.
Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell.
No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying.
See all around, now the nations bow down to sing. The only sound is the praises to Christ, our King. Slowly the names from the book.
No more pain.
time now for the children's story. We'd like to invite the kids to come forward. As they come forward, they'll be collecting an offering that goes for children's ministries. So the kids can come forward at this time. As you can tell, we've had a baby boom this week. Wouldn't it be awesome if all those babies were real? Am I on? Okay. Can you hear me? Well, real, and they were already old enough to be parents and all that, yeah. I'm saying it'd be a blessing to have that many babies in this church in general. It's a senior Bible class assignment that they're doing, and so they're being good parents and taking their babies to Children's Story. So, kids, how many of you like donuts? I have a big, huge donut here.
That's a lie. It's a tire.
This is a donut. It is sugar-free. This is called a donut tire. It is a tire, but it's also called a donut. I'm gonna set that so I don't put the tire straight down on this carpet. There we go, thank you. So, I washed it, but who knows how well. So, this is a donut tire. Do you know what's different between this and a normal tire? This is just for if you have a flat tire and you need to get just a little ways, right? You're not supposed to go real fast on it. But it's smaller, it fits in your trunk easier, it costs less. So they call it a donut tire. And a couple weeks ago, I had something happen that I wanted to tell you about. It was a little miracle. And it started out with, not with me, it started out with Miss Rhonda. And she got up in the morning and came to work, and she saw that her tire was flat. And so she called up Coach Rogers, and Coach Rogers came and he took her flat tire off and put her donut on, and she drove to work. Now, she doesn't have a very far drive. She lives up on the hill there, and she just drives down the hill and she's at work. And so I happened to come in. I was getting ready to go on a vacation, and I was already on vacation, but I needed to do a little bit here at the church office. So I came in, and I happened to come in right when she was about ready to leave, and she goes out there and she looks, and her donut is flat. So she had a flat tire, and then the tire that it was replaced with was flat as well. So I said, well, guess what? My wife drives the exact same kind of car that Miss Rhonda drives. So I went and got her car, got her donut, and put it on Miss Rhonda's car. But my donut from my wife's car was also flat. Now, the reason that one was flat is just because it didn't necessarily leak, it just hadn't been pumped up properly. And so I had to take the donut up to the shop up here and get it all filled back up with air, get it put onto her car, and she was able to drive off fine. And then a little bit later, Mr. Wade went ahead and fixed her tire, and so now she's on good tires. But all that, I was thinking, wow, one tire, another tire, another tire, and that got me thinking, you know what, we're about to go on a long trip, I should check my tires, just make sure they're fully inflated. So I took the car up to the shop to check the tires, and they were all well inflated, which I expected because we just bought the car. We just bought it. It was like a week old, and it had just been to a mechanic to look it over. So we knew everything was in good shape with this car, but as I was filling it up, I saw in the sidewall of my tire was a huge gouge that went all the way down to the metal. There's some metal inside of here. And that tire, once we got going on the freeway real fast, could have exploded and created quite an accident. And so I had to go get the tire replaced before we went on our trip. But the whole time I was thinking, wow, if it wasn't for the fact that Miss Rhonda had problems with her tire, I probably would have never thought to check my tire, and we could have been in danger. So I called her up and I said, your difficult morning here could have saved our lives. And you know what she told me? She said, I was just praising God, because whenever there's something difficult, whenever things are hard, we need to praise God, because God is going to do something. And she said, I was just praising God because it had been such a difficult morning. And then I called her up and told her why God had allowed all this stuff to happen to get me to notice that I needed to check the tire. So God works through even our bad things that happen. He can work good even through the bad things. And he kept our family safe on that trip. And I'm glad he did, aren't you? Thank you. You can go back to your seats. And I don't think anyone wants to eat this donut.
Well, that story fits perfectly with our first song this morning. Has anyone experienced Jesus filling a need that only he could fill this week? I know I have. So our first song is called My Shepherd Will Supply My Need. It's hymn number 104.
He brings my wandering spirit.
Our next song is A Quiet Place. This is one of my favorite hymns, hymn number 503. Now time for our church family prayer. So if you'd like to, you can come up to the front and kneel. We're going to sing our prayer song. I cast all my cares upon you. I lay
on this high Sabbath, Lord, where we celebrate baptisms, Lord. We're grateful to be part of a church that values evangelism, that's been active, Lord. We think of all the victory we've had this year, the souls won through our evangelistic meetings, Lord. We're thankful, Lord, for the progress our schools have made, 2 great years, Lord, for the academies and the elementary school. And to be a part of a church, Lord, that has that's amazing. Lord, we think of our other ministries, our community service center, Lord, what a difference it has made as well this year. Think of our Pathfinder program, Lord. We are so blessed to be a part of a church so active in reaching souls for the kingdom. And I'm thankful, Lord, for all the people who have volunteered and responded to the nominating committee, Lord, to make this another great 2 years moving forward. Pray you dedicate all those individuals, Lord, who've agreed to serve you in this church. Father, we're thankful for them, and we just pray that you lead. Lord, we come before you now, and we present our requests. Lord, there are many people here who are suffering physically, with health problems, you know them, Lord, financially, maybe relationally, Lord, lots of challenges in this world that Satan throws in our way to keep us from you. I pray that we'll keep our eyes on you, Lord, stay focused on you, and you'll guide us forward. Father, I pray for our community here. I pray for camp meeting that's coming up, the graduation services that are coming up, Lord. These are all your events, and we know you will lead. Just pray for your outpouring of your Holy Spirit on them, that others will be drawn closer to you. Father, we pray for our church, and as we go through transition, Lord, we pray that you will lead in that as well. Be with our community here in Portland, Lord. It has its needs too. May we be a light to them. Be with our state, our country, this world, Lord. It needs you more than ever, and I pray that we will be there to help guide the world to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from 1 Samuel 16:7. But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees. For the Lord looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart."
We have a very rare hymn to play for you this morning. It's rare in that, to the best of my knowledge, everybody knows it and everybody loves it. Jesus loves me.
Thank you for the music. Both songs were great. And I told Kristen, she did something to me. She told me they were going to be doing that shepherd song. I'd never heard it before. So I looked it up yesterday. And then it was stuck in my mind all day long. That's a neat little song. Thanks for introducing that. It's been a great Sabbath already. Great to have people make their decisions for baptism. We're going to miss the students once graduation is over, and many of you go back to your homes for the summertime. Place isn't quite the same without you. But you know, it's been a good year. A lot of emphasis on evangelism. And you know, it's not an event. It is an attitude. It's a lifestyle. And through this summertime, we're going to keep up that attitude and lifestyle, because in October, we're going to have another event. And the event is only as good as the preparation for it. And speaking of that, in a couple weeks, we have an event that is on this campus, camp meeting. And it's a great opportunity to invite some of your friends, neighbors, to come on out, especially for the children's programs. You know, a lot of people send their kids to something like a VBS, which is basically what they can envision our children's programs are like. And it's a good connection. It's a good way to introduce people to our church and our campus. And the opening night, the opening weekend speaker, Derek Morris, he's pretty well known, but I don't know if you've ever heard him preach. We know him for Sabbath school and stuff, but the guy is an amazing preacher. In fact, when they took him out of preaching and put him behind a pen, I thought, what a tragedy. He's one of the best preachers in our denomination. Well, he's back out preaching, so that's good news. So thank you, Elder Haley, for bringing him back so we can hear him preach. So I'd like to encourage you to see camp meeting not just as something for us, but it's an opportunity to connect others in with us and have some great inspirational preaching. Would you bow your heads with me as I pray? Dear Father in heaven, we're so blessed to see so many young people today give their lives, their talents, their attitudes, all that to you. And we know that you have blessed us through these schools, and we pray that we can bless you back through our faithfulness. And now as we turn to your word, I pray for your Holy Spirit to take charge of this time. Let the things that are said not be mine, but be yours. Interpret it for each person as it is needed for them today. Some person may have come here needing a specific message from you, and we trust that you can provide that for them. In Jesus' name, amen. Matan cried out in pain as blood dripped down his arm from another self-inflicted wound. In the recesses of a tomb that had been chiseled out of stone, Matan curled up his unclothed body in a ball and rocking back and forth in pain. But the pain was not so much from the pain of the cut, the pain of what he had done to himself. No, it was from an inner turmoil that was inside of him. And we don't know the exact cause of what his emotional pain was. At least we don't know the beginning of what that was. But we do know that Satan had held this poor man captive for a very, very long time. He had become so out of control that the people of his village had tried to restrain him unsuccessfully, and he had eventually been driven away out into the countryside, where he lived among the tombs, and he isolated himself from all of society. Satan wanted him there so he could keep him away from people and drown him in his pain. Mark chapter 5 describes this man in this way. The last part of verse 2 says that he was a man with an unclean, moving to verse 3, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains, and the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces. Neither could anyone tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying out and cutting himself with stones. The book of Matthew, chapter 8, verse 26, adds in that he was a fierce man, and he wouldn't let anybody pass by. When we look at the story in Luke, chapter 8, verse 27, it tells us that he didn't wear any clothes, but he lived in tombs instead of in a house. And to many, this man, whom I'm calling Matan, seems like some sort of an otherworldly, scary brute, hardly even a human. And yet when I look at this story, I see somebody who's dealing with deep pain in his life. And today, thousands, maybe millions of people are suffering with hurt that manifests itself in similar ways, similar manifestations of pain that could intimidate others. Now, obviously, I'm not saying that people who manifest pain in these ways are necessarily demon-possessed, as Matan was, but over 2,000 years later, Satan is still using these same methods to keep people captive in their pain. So these people, they may not be demon-possessed, but it is still demons who are influencing them to self-destructive coping methods. That's not the way God operates, is it? And we see these things nowadays as modern-day issues. You know, Matan, he violently blocked people from out of his life. And don't we see that now? Some people respond to their pain with violence, keeping people away through just brute force. Others, what do? They retreat. They close down. They push people away. They may seem dead to the world, but really, they're just trying to survive. And they may crave social interaction, but it seems too overwhelming, seems daunting, like they can't possibly do it. It's easier just push back. And as a side, I want to mention, if you have a friend who is pushing you away and you know they have pain, don't give up. Most likely, they really do want you to keep checking on them, even if they don't respond well. We also see this sort of pain in the modern fascination with death and the occult. You know, Matan, he was living in the tombs, right? His life was based around death. He knew death was coming, and he was just hanging out right there his whole time. That was where he found comfortable. And a lot of people these days are doing a similar thing. They may not be living in the tombs, but they obsess over death, or they may wear jewelry and stuff that has skulls, and they wear clothes that are intended to be dark or morbid. You see that a lot, and we say, oh, what's wrong with these people? Well, most likely, there's some deep pain going on there. They don't realize that the very one who's responsible for their pain is using this morbid fascination to keep them in their pain. A couple of Sabbaths ago, I was back in Birmingham, where my previous church was, and there was a man who came to church that Sabbath, much to my surprise. I had befriended him while I was there, and I was surprised to see him, very pleasantly surprised to see him. This man was one of those who was just very obsessed with evil, with the dark side. His big thing was he loved Halloween, and he obsessed with Halloween year-round. And whenever he walked around, you could see he was walking under a load of just a heavy burden, and his eyes were not clear. His breath reeked of substances that helped him to cope. But I saw him coming to church, and there was a brightness in his eyes. There was a smile on his face, and he excitedly told me, "Steve, I gave up Halloween, and I feel so much more free." We see this. This is not stuff that happened 2,000 years ago, and it was over. This is happening these days. And I was so happy for his freedom. Another area where we see Matan's pain coming out, just he was unclothed. And you know, throughout the Bible, unless it's between spouses, this condition of being unclothed is a condition of shame, right? Over and over, that is shame. And yet this man, Matan, he had so fully embraced his shame. He had such a low picture of himself that he was just completely embracing it. And today we see many people try to mask their poor sense of self-worth, their shame in themselves, through objectifying their bodies. Maybe not as completely as he did, but sadly still. One other specific coping mechanism that it mentions in this passage is that Matan was involved in cutting. Some of you may not know what cutting is. Unfortunately, more of you know than should. Cutting is something that is still very relevant today. People, especially young teens, will cut themselves, inflicting pain. And it's almost like what they're doing is the pain inside is harder to deal with than the pain on the outside. And even though most people who do this realize that it's unhealthy and hide it from their parents and their friends, it can be very addicting. I've known people who were involved in that until Jesus was able to rescue them. And so, yes, this man, Matan, was in a worse physical condition than most of the people that you and I know. But his hurt was the same. Whether it's 2,000 years ago or whether it's right now, that same kind of hurt exists. Hundreds of thousands of people are living in a world of pain, desperately seeking a way out. So let's get back to the story in Mark chapter 5, and let's see how Jesus deals with Matan. Matan is in the cave, and he's consoling himself the best that he can in his lonely existence. And as he's there, crying out in the cave, he senses a different sort of presence invading his space. Now, we don't know how it was that he was able to recognize that there was something different happening, but as he looked up, he looked out to the cave, he saw a boat come to the shore and a man get out of that boat. How he knew that this man was the solution to his problem, the Bible doesn't tell us, but somehow he sensed that this man was who he needed to go to. And his response opens a window for us in understanding and hearing the unspoken in people's lives. Mark chapter 5, beginning in verse 6. Mark chapter 5, verse 6. By the way, if you're following along and you're using the Pew Bible, the page number on the right-hand side of your screen is the page number for this. Mark chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. When he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshiped him. And he cried out with a loud voice and said, "What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you by God that you do not torment me." For he had said to him, "Come out of this man, unclean spirit." You notice two seemingly conflicting responses here. On the one hand, he worships Jesus. And on the other hand, he insults him. On the one hand, he runs to Jesus. On the other hand, he's terrified because he believes that Jesus wants to torture him. How do you make sense of these two things? Jesus knew that he had to look beyond the words, which were being controlled by his pain, in this case, directly by demons, and to his heart, which was revealed by his actions of running and falling down at Jesus' feet. No matter how much control Satan exerts over a person, he can never keep that person from coming to Jesus if they want to. I want to say that again. There is nothing that Satan can do to keep you from coming to Jesus if you want to. Even in this case, he wasn't even, Satan had enough control over this man where he could keep him from even being able to call out to Jesus, but he couldn't keep him from running to him. A friend of mine, Charlie, he was a pastor, he's retired now. He was doing some mission work in the Philippines. And they had this big, huge meeting. I think there's probably about 1,000 people all gathered around. And he was preaching the gospel, and people were all excited and blessed to hear it. And suddenly there's this commotion in the back. This lady walks in from the very back, and she starts screaming hateful obscenities. Not just at Pastor Charlie, but at God himself. And as she's screaming these hateful things, she's walking slowly up to the front. And Pastor Charlie stopped preaching because no one was paying attention to what he was saying anymore. They were all listening to this lady who was cursing God right in church. She walked right up to the front, and she is just raving in anger and hatred toward God and toward Pastor Charlie and toward the church and toward all this stuff. And Pastor Charlie and the elders, they surrounded her, and they begin to pray. They prayed for deliverance. It was clear that she was possessed by an evil spirit, and they begin to pray for her. And after some persevering prayer, the demon left her, and she was left with this great sense of peace. And she said, "I came here today because I wanted to be set free from Satan. But when I came, he wouldn't even let me say what I wanted to say." But Satan could not prevent her from coming to Jesus. Satan can never keep a person from coming to Jesus if they want to come. And I believe that this applies not only to demon-possessed people. As I mentioned before, people dealing with pain in very harmful ways, they may not be demon-possessed, but it's demons that lead them to these harm. It's demons that are torturing them in their pain. They're leading them into self-destructive behaviors. And they may be so deep in their pain that they don't even know how to express with their mouth what they're thinking. They may not understand how to get beyond that, because it's like they're drowning in that. When I was about 4 or 5 years old, I was at the Pacific Ocean chasing the waves, and a wave caught me and pulled me under. And I can still to this day remember seeing the gray green of the water swirling around me and the seaweed wrapping around my head, and I was completely powerless. There was nothing I could do. I felt completely helpless until I saw my dad's leather work boot with red shoelaces step right next to me. And the next thing I knew, he was lifting me out by my hair. That's why I'm bald today. No, just kidding. But that sense of being completely helpless as powers that are stronger than you are swirling around you is what it feels like to be in this deep pain. And you may not be able to express that. You may not even know what to say, but no one can keep you from coming to Jesus if you want to come. Unfortunately, unlike Jesus, we can't read the intent of a person's heart, so sometimes we have to back off to avoid allowing abuse, right? But when we see somebody coming, even if they don't appear like the perfect candidate for baptism, even if they come to us rough and even caustic, like Jesus, we need to look through the pain and see, are they coming to Jesus? And I want to be clear, I'm not saying that we should tolerate abuse in order to save somebody. Sometimes we do that. We stay in an abusive situation thinking that if we just stay long enough, they'll change. That doesn't work, guys. It just doesn't work. I'm not saying that we should endanger innocent people because of a dangerous person. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is when somebody, I'm talking about looking beyond a person's exterior to seeing a heart that's reaching out for Jesus. If someone walks into this church dressed more like a harlot than a holy person, it may be easy to assume that this person is not open to Christ, but they're here, aren't they? Maybe she can't express what's on her heart, but she's here. Could it be here because she's looking for an answer to her pain? Jesus looked beyond the naked, scarred body of Matan to see a man who is hurting and could one day be one of his greatest evangelists. And if a loved one is vociferously arguing against your faith, maybe they're under conviction. Don't give up. Keep inviting. Keep inviting. Verse 8, Mark chapter 5 and verse 8. Remember, we read that first he had told the unclean spirit to come out of the man. Then verse 8, for he had said to him, come out of the man, unclean spirit. Then he asked him, what is your name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. Also, he begged him earnestly that he should not send them out of the country. Now, a large herd of swine was feeding there near the mountains. So all the demons begged him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter them. And at once, without even considering twice, at once Jesus gave them permission. Then the unclean spirits went out.
In the sea. Notice that Jesus didn't ignore the demons. He didn't pretend they didn't matter. He engaged with them and cast them out. Sometimes when people come to us with pain, we think we'll just pray the problems away. And prayer is a very important part of it, but prayer leads to action, doesn't it? In fact, I've found that my very best prayer times have always led me to action. A willingness to walk with somebody through the pain, to stick with them, to call them up on the phone and say, how you doing? And then do it again. And then do it again. And notice also that Jesus is willing to go to great lengths to help this man. First, what does he do? He specifically goes across the river, or across the sea. Why does he do that? Like, there was only one thing that he did while he was there. He went across the sea to interact with this man. That was the only thing he did. And while he was there, he had to fight with a big, huge storm that threatened to kill him. I wonder if maybe the reason that storm came was because Satan knew that Jesus was about to free one of his captives, and he didn't want that to happen. I don't know if that's the reason, but he fought the storm, and then he was willing to sacrifice all these pigs, even though it would be great financial loss for the villagers, and it would get him kicked out of town, because this one man that no one else cared about, mattered to him. The story goes on to tell how the demons caused the pigs to go run violent down into the embankment. And the people who kept the pigs, they ran and they told all about it. Verse 15, when they, that is the people who kept the pigs and the villagers, when they came to Jesus and saw one who had been demon-possessed and had a legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind, they were what? They were amazed. They were excited. They cheered. No, they were afraid. Jesus had not only freed this man from his bondage, but he had provided him clothing, because no longer was he in bondage to shame. Jesus was restoring his dignity in a very physical way, not just a spiritual way. He didn't just say, you're forgiven. He said, I'm going to cover you up. And you know what? I think Jesus could have just manufactured those clothes, but I don't think he did. I think either Jesus or one of his disciples pulled clothes out of their own possessions and gave it to this man in order to sacrifice for themselves to give dignity to a person who was hurting. But I also notice in here that the villagers, these same people who had tried unsuccessfully to restrain Matan, were more afraid of a power that could cast the demons out than they were of the demons themselves. In fact, what did they do? Mark 15 says they were afraid. And verse 16, Mark 5, 16, and those who saw it told them how it happened to him, and how it happened to him who had been demon-possessed, and about the swine. And what do? They begin to plead with him to depart from their region. You see, Matan recognized that Jesus' power, even while he was in a deranged state, and he ran to Jesus for deliverance. But the villagers were terrified of that same power. Both Matan and the villagers recognized that if they allowed the power of God to come into their lives, there was going to be a change. The difference was Matan was willing to give up everything. He was so low, he knew there was nothing else to lose. The villagers were still holding on to what kept them comfortable and safe. No one can keep you from coming to Jesus if you want to, but pride and self-sufficiency can keep you from wanting to. Too many people learn this the hard way. They find out some new truth about the Bible, and that new truth requires them to make a change in their lives. But rather than accepting the power of God in their lives, instead they just stick with the old. They stick with the old 2,000 dead pigs floating in the water. It's more comfortable for them than giving that up in order to receive what Jesus has to offer them. Jesus didn't force the matter. When he was begged to leave, he left. But he commissioned Matan to go do his work. Verse 18. And when he got into the boat, he who had been demon-possessed begged him that he might be with him. Of course he did. Why wouldn't he want to go with Jesus? But Jesus didn't permit him. Instead, he said, go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he has had compassion on you. And he departed and began to proclaim in all Decapolis all that Jesus had done for him, and all marveled. So we see that Jesus had heard his unspoken plea from this man's heart. He went out of his way. He fought a storm to free him. He gave him his dignity back. And then he gave him a commission to share his testimony. And as believers, we should follow that. How successful was Matan? Next time Jesus came back, all the village came out to greet him, because he shared his testimony. And that's one way that we can redeem our pain, by sharing what Jesus has done through that. Remember, nothing can keep someone from coming to Jesus if they want to come to him. But what if you're Matan? We've talked about how we should relate to people like Matan, but what if you're Matan? What if right now you are secretly holding in pain, shame, and guilt? What if you feel like you can't get a breath? Maybe you're secretly cutting yourself. Maybe you're dealing with shame and through some other unhealthy method, or indulging in morbid thoughts. Remember, nothing can keep you from coming to Jesus, even if you don't know how to express yourself to him. I want to read a passage from Romans chapter 8, and I'm going to do it from the New Living Translation, because I think it really speaks well. And as I read this, if you're a Matan, put your own name into this. In fact, I'm going to make it easy by using the personal pronoun. I'm going to change we to me. This is Romans 8, verse 38. It says, I am convinced that nothing can ever separate me from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither my fears for today nor my worries for tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate me from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate me from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus, my Lord. Nothing can keep you from coming to Jesus. Jesus went to great lengths to save Matan. He will go to great lengths to save you as well. Of course, that means openly talking to God about your pain. But what if, like Matan, you feel like you don't know how to do that? I've got good news for you. Romans 8, verse 26 talks about that very thing. Likewise, the Holy Spirit also helps in our weakness. Do you feel weak to come to Jesus? For we don't know what to say as we, what to pray as we ought. I've been there. I've been like, I don't even know, Lord, what to say. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be heard. You come to Jesus, even if you don't have the words to say, and Jesus knows. He hears the unspoken. So it starts with prayer. But it probably also means opening up to a trusted friend, a parent, a counselor, a pastor. I'm so happy that next year we're going to be opening up a counseling center for our young people in our schools. Isn't that a blessing to have that ability? But you know what? When you do open up, Satan will whisper into your ear that there's too much shame in it. That people will just reject you. That it's just best to retreat back into your tombs and keep people at arm's length. But listen, it's not helping, is it? Give it a try. We hear horror stories about people rejecting people when they say their pain. Unfortunately, that happens sometimes, but most of the time it doesn't. So reach out. But when you do, remember that the person you're reaching out to is not Jesus. They can't solve your pain. All they can do is walk with you to Jesus. So don't expect them to solve it, but opening up will help. And Christian, if somebody opens up to you, don't be intimidated. You don't have to have the answer. You couldn't have the answer. Your job isn't to solve their hurt. It's to be a listening, caring ear, to pray for them, pray with them, and depending on the situation, get them some professional help. Jesus hears the unspoken. We're Jesus followers. We need to pray that he will give us ears to hear the unspoken. Father in heaven, every one of us comes to you as a broken person. But you've done great things in so many of our lives. Let us be faithful in passing on the love, the care, even to those who may not appear to be open. As you bring people to us and us to people, give us eyes to see them as you do, not as the world sees them. And never let it be said that there is any place where they can experience more love than right here. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to invite the people who are baptized to come forward. We've got to welcome them into our church. So come on forward at this time. And I think Pastor Roger is going to do the honors here.
All right, we have Daniel and Michelle and Amelia come forward. These fine young people have made it very clear that they want to follow Jesus. And now we need to make it clear that we're with them and support them on the way. What's your pleasure is inviting them to be members in good standing at the Highland Seventh-day Adventist Church. It's been moved and seconded. All in favor say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
All right, and nobody's opposed to that, I'm sure. Amelia, we have a certificate for you if I can find your name there. This one's for Daniel. Thank you. This one is for Amelia. And this one's for Misael. Very good. We also have, we want to share a copy so that you have your own copy of Steps to Christ, beautiful book. You may already have a copy. That's fine. Share it with a friend. But we wanted to make sure that you had a wonderful copy here, Steps to Christ. It will help in your journey with Jesus. And we're so pleased that that you have made this decision. Now, what we're going to do here, you guys know the drill. They're going to stay by a while, and so that you can come up and congratulate them, welcome into the fellowship. Now, we've already voted the Johnson family into membership, but I think it's appropriate. Why don't you come up and join us, too, so the folks can welcome you to our fellowship as well. They are voted into membership just a few moments ago. So come on up, Logan and Eric. So good to have you as part of our family as well. And I know we already prayed, but maybe a prayer of blessing here as we dismiss and praise God for what he's doing here at Highland. Lord, thank you so much for the message heard today, for the opportunity that we have to gather in your name and worship and bring praises to your name. Lord, I pray that as we dismiss one from another, that we will leave with a song in our heart, knowing that we are children of the living God. Bless these new members of our church here. I pray that not only will the church be a blessing to them, but they would also be a blessing to us as we minister together to a world in need. We praise your name, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen. Thank you so much for coming, and you're dismissed at this time.
Thank you, guys.